Good afternoon, everyone. If you've been preaching on the gospel, you know that the bread of life has been the theme and always is the theme for several weeks. And one of I think you all know, I love this Bread for the Journey by Henry Nouwen. That's just beautiful devotions. And this last weekend, I had the opportunity to reconnect with some Concordia friends that I probably haven't seen in 40 years. And it was just an absolute delight. And we, of course, had went out for dinner. And I think we were there 4 hours. And it was kind of one of those dinners where you don't want it to end. You want to just keep going. You want to continue to, although we were stuffed, you want to just continue to eat and laugh and converse and all of those great things. And I'm sure you've had those kinds of experiences in the past. But when we think about the bread of life, I think about that kind of a dinner, being able to come to the table with Christ, being able to eat and drink and converse and be in community together, something that we have sorely been lacking this last year and a half. And I read from Henry Nouwen's Bread for the Journey. Jesus gives himself to us. When we invite friends for a meal, we do much more than offer them food for their bodies. We offer friendship, fellowship, good conversation, intimacy, and closeness. When we say, help yourself, take some more, don't be shy, have another glass, we offer our guests not only our food and our drink, but also ourselves. A spiritual bond grows and we become food and drink for one another. In the most complete and perfect way, this happens when Jesus gives himself to us in the Eucharist as food and drink. By offering us his body and blood, Jesus offers us the most intimate communion possible. It is a divine communion. I just finished, it's a two-day morning sessions with ELCA Churchwide for admin assistance as they switched to a new platform. And so we were doing training and talking about all of the effects of COVID on our lives and our churches and just how we communicate with one another and how do we, in the midst of having to be distanced and separated and having various protocols in place and going more virtual, how do we maintain that in-person closeness was the topic that we talked about for one of the sections. And I think about that even today as we are, you know, many places are back in person, but people are watching on the horizon as we look at the Delta variant and whatever variant comes after that one. And the kind of the ebb and flow of how we need to care for one another and what that involves. And so we do miss out on that being close, being called as community. So I invite you as you gather for text study or if you gather in your conference or if you gather just over coffee or Zoom or whatever, take some time to figure out how each of you can increase that sense of community, that sense of being one with one another as we are one with Christ. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who comes to us in his vulnerability, who comes to us as a babe born in a manger, who comes to us and gives us his all. He gives us his life. He gives us his love. He gives us his grace and mercy, gifts from you, gifts for us, gifts for the world. We ask that during these challenging times that we continue to find ways to be one with one another, to build those strong bonds of relationship, to continue to build the relationship that we have with you through Christ Jesus. Empower these leaders that they may go forth. Renew them, energize them, nourish them, fill them with your Holy Spirit, that they may be proclaimers of your light and love. In your name we pray. Amen. Chris, you want to lead us through the agenda today?
Sure. Pastor Keith is up next. Thank you, Pastor Carla, for the devotion. Pastor Keith.
Thank you. Good to see all of you and also to see your names clearly before us. And thank you, Carla, for that centering word, a good word. And as we are mindful about community and being together in Christ for God's mission that the Holy Spirit stirs up, we can celebrate that Jesus is alive. There is a resurrection that has happened and is happening, and the Holy Spirit stirring. And I'm glad to have this opportunity just quickly to lift up what you probably have already heard about. In fact, let me just check out something with you. Those of you who have your videos on with your thumbs up or down, indicating that you have seen this cross the desk in your office, a mailing that went out last week about practicing resurrection, experiencing vitality. And for those of you that are not with us with the video feed, if you could in the chat say yes or no. When we do these casting the bread on the water, it's good to know if it's being seen. And I just wanted to check with you at this moment about whether you've had a chance both either to see this or you were recipients and your congregational presidents of an email blast that went out that put everything forward about the opportunities for congregations to consider being a part of the next cohort of congregational teams taking the practicing resurrection journey that we're gearing up for and excited about. I'm going to invite Chris at this moment to take you to the actual website that is readily and easily accessible. And a big shout out to you, Chris, for making this happen. Appreciate that. So when you go to the to our Synod webpage, this is one of the scrolling panels. You click that, it brings you right here. And I'm going to invite Chris to pull up an introductory few minute video. Or were we going to end with that? Sorry about that.
No, that's okay. Do you want me to show it? Just so everyone knows, most of the letters were sent out on Thursday. By the time the mail went on Moorhead, there was a handful that didn't go out until Friday. So Pastor Keith, did you want me to show the video now? I can.
Why don't we go back to that page? And I got ahead of myself. And I wanted to just have you pull up the letter that had all the links just to show them that. And then the other piece was the preparing for the journey timeline. So if you just pull up the letter, that's what that looks like if you haven't already seen it, but it's on one page. And I think it provides much for you to think about, discern, and make some decisions as to the relevancy and timeliness of it for you. And then correspondingly with that letter, there was one other page that thought was worthwhile as a standalone. It's also included in the PowerPoint, and that's the timeline for the workshops, the registration, so on and so on. And you'll notice when you go back to the other page or go back to the menu of the different bullets, there's a ready to go registration that is going to be easy to navigate. It looks for one person representative of the congregation to register the congregation if they choose to take the journey. And it's pretty easy to follow, but we're always ready to stand by with any assistance. And now I'd like to see if we could just look at this few minute video, and then I'll just have a Q&A moment or two with you before we turn it on to the turn to the next agenda item.
Practicing Resurrection and Experiencing Vitality is a unique partnership between Hope Partnership for Missional Transformation, which is an ecumenical national organization and the Northwest Synod of the ELCA. And in this partnership, we work together to help create transformative leaders who can transform congregations and adapt those congregations for this new era of mission and ministry that we're a part of. And in addition to that, we hopefully will work with them to help them transform their congregations. So their congregations will connect to God's mission in unique ways that are unique to and specific to the particular location that that church is located in. And it's a very exciting process. It's it is a process that takes place over about a 9-month period of time. It's highly engaging. Individuals. We engage people in interactive workshops and all kinds of events in order to help them get and to achieve those goals. And at the end of the whole process, congregations have a plan that'll take them for the next 5 years. Congregations have a good sense of what their God is calling them to do in their particular location. And at the end, most leaders look at their role as a Christian leader in a very different way. We're in a different space. People are thinking differently about our church right now. To wait any longer, our churches are gonna get back to normal. We're gonna get back to walking the dog in terms of what we're doing in terms of mission. We're gonna just be back in our old habits. So if you wanna put a bookmark or start a new chapter as a life of a congregation, then this is a great time to get engaged. I know a lot of congregations like to think that we can just put this off and we can think about doing it at other times. But if you look at any of the data out there about what congregations are facing and what congregations are dealing with, economic models are not going to work much longer. A lot of our preconceived notions about worship are not going to be working a lot longer. Many of our churches, if you look at the gray hair in those churches, you can see that things are not going to be the same as time goes on. And so this is a wonderful time for congregations to think about transforming themselves and to really taking another look at what it is we're about and what we're doing.
Thank you. Thank you, Chris. First journey involved just before COVID hit. We had our first workshop at Grace Lutheran in Detroit Lakes, and we were off to a great start. And but COVID hit, and we carried on despite. It was pretty remarkable, actually, with the other workshops and the homework that happened in between. And that sense of camaraderie and companionship and journey with other congregations and the cross-pollinization and learning was a delight, even though we weren't able to be in person in the same way as we were in the first workshop. There were 12 congregational teams, representative of 18 congregations involving 57 leaders. So we had some teams that were representative of parishes, multi-point parishes, as well as single congregations. The sizes range from small to large, and it was a wonderful interaction and interplay. We're excited to see what might happen and what might gel with the next cohort of congregations. We are anticipating with the first workshop, of which is referred to on that page that Hope or that Chris went to, that listed everything that's just a click away regarding the snake's journey, is the actual flyer for the first workshop on the 16th of October at Grace Lutheran in Detroit Lakes. And so there's a prime time right now for discernment, discussion, and some decision-making as to whether this seems like the right time for you and the congregations that you are serving. And this is a team effort. We're so privileged. We've got a wonderful team of your colleagues. It's like from the field, for the field, the partners with Rick Morris. And so it's also pastoral led, if you will, or leader led from our synod. You'll see those names clearly on the letter. The letter comes from them, from the team. So questions that I can attempt to answer, or you could put in the chat and we could capture later in some conversation I would be willing to have with you later. But if I would just invite Chris, both in terms of chats or if there is a hand waving or not, if there's anything immediately, knowing that we can talk later as well. All right.
Just in terms of the payment, Pastor Keith, can you speak to like the fact that it's reduced and how payment can happen for people?
Yeah, the $400 overall investment can be made and it can be allocated. Let's say $100 for each workshop or all up front or half and half. It's worth noting that we received a grant from our ELCA made possible by your mission support from your congregations that cycled back to our synod that helps us underwrite this transformational ministry leadership development and work. So that $400 can be, as you see registration, you can use a credit card or you can just simply write a check and bring it with to a workshop or send it to the synod office. Pretty negotiable and very flexible. We did invite congregations that went through the experience the first time because of COVID that if they wanted to take another run at it to beef up what they had experienced and add to some new people, we also were offering $100 off of that, so $300 for those. And those congregations that were represented in June at the introductory workshop, there's $25 coming off of that $400. So, but wait. No, I'm not going to do it, but wait, there's another offer. Anything else? Oh. There are small, of the 18 congregations, several of which were part of a multi-point, the average gathering of those worshiping on a given week range from just being under 70 down into the teens. And for some medium size or larger membership congregation, they were in that area of 200 plus gathering for worship on a Sunday. So we had congregations that had multi-staff and we had also multi-point parishes that had a sense of teaming. And we had solo pastorates and also synodic authorized ministers were are really significant leaders, as we know, and were in this process. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. And you all know how to get a hold of Pastor Keith. We will be celebrating his ministry on Sunday, August 29th. He probably doesn't want me saying this publicly, but we're gonna have a celebration. He will retire from doing this ministry as our director of evangelical mission. And so Sunday, August 29th at Our Savior's Lutheran Church here in Moorhead. Please come and send greetings. He's done amazing work, and I know all of you know that firsthand.
Hey, I'm retiring.
You're retiring.
Oh my gosh. All right.
Didn't Cheryl tell you?
Chris, why don't you mention the time again for that gathering?
Yeah. It's 3 to 5. And then at 5 o'clock, we're going to have a short program. So it's open house style and then a short program at 5 o'clock. There's information in tomorrow's Northern Lights if you're not writing down fast enough. So the next the next thing on the agenda is to share about the theology of for ministry retreat. I've always called it fall theological. But in our compensation guidelines, it says theology for ministry retreat. So I'm trying to use that term. People who are on the planning team, if I forget anything, please jump in and make sure I'm not forgetting stuff. Registration will open on August 19th. So next Thursday. Next Thursday. And we're doing it that way just because, as you guys all know, in the last year and a half, it's hard to plan things. And so we decided that was our go or no go date. I will send out an email either late on the 18th or early on the 19th with the information. We are cautiously optimistic that we can meet in person. We are meeting at Luther Crest Bible Camp. A couple of things that I've gotten some questions about: housing with COVID and having all of you be adults. I figured you wouldn't want to sleep all, like some of you might want to sleep in a bunk bed, but I didn't want to assume that you wanted to go camp style. And so there's three options that I've set up. You can stay in a cabin with at least three other people of your choosing. There's a Google form to fill in. And that's $70 for the two nights. And the rooms are lovely, especially the new rooms at Luther Crest are lovely, but you choose who you are going to be with for that. And then I reserved a block of rooms at the Hampton Inn and Suites. And you would book that like you were booking a hotel room for a getaway for you or for a trip or whatever. We do have a reduced price for that, but if you want a roommate to help pay for it, you can do that. Or if you want the room yourself, however you want to do that, but you contact the Hampton Inn and Suites yourself. That information was in the letter that was sent out. Arrowwood Resort is a little bit closer to Luther Crest, but they wouldn't give me a block of rooms because the weekend before is the grape stomp. And so they, if you can come early, come to the grape stomp at Carlos Creek Winery. But there's rooms available, but you would just need to book, but I don't have a block of rooms for there. I looked at previous costs for our conference, and they were, the last time we were able to be together, it was over $300 total for the programming and the food and all of that. So for our registration, it just covers the meals and our programming costs, and it's $140. So then the housing is however you choose, and that will be on top of it. Some wonderful rostered leaders from conferences 7 and 8 are part of the planning team pulling this together. Our presenters are Trey Everett and Mary Francis. And we're gonna be doing things a little bit differently than what would be normal. Our theme is Rhythms of Grace, focusing on reuniting, recentering, rest, renewal, and reconnecting. If you look at the schedule, that the tentative schedule, you'll notice that our shared life and ministry together is on Tuesday morning. Bishop Bill's son is getting married that weekend before, and so he probably won't be with us on that Sunday night. And also, Bishop Bill isn't with us today, and I should have led with this. He's taking some respite time with family right now and tending to urgent matters. Like I just got an email that I will share with you all at the end. But most of the time, he will be with us for sure on Tuesday, but hopefully most of Monday as well. Team, we have a couple of questions. I assume the hotel rooms are doubles for 123. Yes. I got a mixture of kings and doubles. So you can choose whatever you want to do. And commuters, if you want to commute, then you just need to pay that registration fee of $140, and that will cover the programming and all meals at Luther Crest, and they make some delicious food there, especially if they make their monster cookies, which I'm going to ask about. So if there's other questions, and people on the planning team, if you, if I forgot anything, let me know. We have a great list of free time activities. What if we're willing to room with other people, but you don't have one to request as a roommate? That's a great question. I will start maybe like a Google sheet for people to put their information down. That's a great idea. I'll make that today, and it will be in tomorrow's Northern Lights. All right, I think that's enough for that. We're gonna move on to one of my least favorite topics, something that keeps me up at night, is COVID. A few things I need to get my computer ready. The CDC has come out with, and as a synod, we don't give mandates, we give recommendations and guidance. And throughout this whole time, we've been recommending following the CDC and the Minnesota Department of Health. The CDC has, you guys all know what it's like to share a screen on Zoom and not have the right web page ready, I'm sure. So CDC's website, this is their homepage, their coronavirus. The main thing I wanted, they have a lot of information in this guidance for fully vaccinated people. One thing that I've been checking often is this county tracking map. If you look at our synod, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 synods in our county right now that are moderate or low. So that means all of the other synods that are orange or red, the CDC recommends you to wear masks, whether you're vaccinated or not, in public indoor spaces. I'll put this link in the chat. I'm sure you've looked at it. Another thing is that the Minnesota Department of Health hasn't changed their guidance for places of worship since June. So I've been digging through the school's stuff because from my experience in congregations, we often, at least for faith formation, followed what the school districts did. So there's information on here for the best practices for schools, and I'll put this link in the chat as well. Each school district can choose what they do. And so if you still have your SMART team, if not everyone has run away from your SMART team, or you have connections to people on the school board or school administration, I would reach out to them to kind of see what they're planning. I'm sure they're still figuring it out, what they're going to be doing. So yeah, that's the new exciting news from the CDC of Minnesota Department of Health. I'm going to pass the baton to Pastor Carla.
Thanks, Chris. You know, you think you're over some of these things, but COVID still lurks and we still have to deal with it. So One of the things that we were talking about is we've had, we do once a month conference call with the conference deans. And among the various items that we talk about, we are making a transition in the call process that I want to let you know about. The deans will be responsible for orienting call committees to the work of the ministry site profile. And so our engagement ministers will be doing the exit interviews. So we're just kind of swapping duties there in the call process. And so engagement ministers are Kathy Levenhagen for conferences 1 and 2, Karen Young-Trenny for 3 and 5, Janelle Netland for 4 and 6, and Brad Scogan for 7 and 8. And so our deans, who are close at hand to congregations in their conference areas, will help call committees with orienting them to that ministry site profile work. We also talked about, it's amazing that even during COVID and the challenges that we've had in the past year and a half, we have had tremendous transition throughout our synod. Pastors, new pastors coming into our synod, and pastors also moving within our synod. And I know up front I'm going to miss somebody, but I just want to give you a little bit of a list of what's been happening in the last year or so. And we have several people on our call, but for instance, we have new people like Rachel Johnson, who's serving up at Williams and Roosevelt up in Conference 1. We have a new Sam Marilyn Grandstrand, and she's helping out at First in Stephen. Megan and Andy Graves have started up in Conference 1. Megan is at Grace and Red River, and Andy is at Sion in Lancaster. Marilyn Grafstrom is a seminary student, and she is going to be with the Grigla Parish for a couple years as she attends seminary. We've got, of course, Jeff Brown joined us at St. Paul's in Crookston, and Maggie Bierkness is at Our Savior's in East Grand Forks. Devlin Brooks finished his seminary work and was called to Faith in Wolverton. Katie Demera, she is serving as a SAM for this new area strategy that is, Keith is working with those congregations, but it's the Gary Parish and the Bijou Parish. So 6 congregations working together, and Katie is also helping them out in a role as a SAM. I'm just amazed at how our candidacy students want to be involved in congregations, and it's just really exciting. We've had Michelle Jensen, who continues on as now the she's waving. If you see her waving there, continues on as pastor in Purley and Grandin, and we've got Chantel Langford, who has been serving at Nidaros, and we've got current seminary students like Curtis Peterson. He's a SAM who's serving at Glendon. And we've got people who have been on leave from call, like Kelly Ahula, who's now helping out at the Peace Parish, and Shelley. And we have a new Presbyterian pastor coming into our synod, Michael Ozaki, who will be serving up in Crookston at Trinity and First Presbyterian. John Dalen was just installed at Bethany and Nevis, and Ruth Hetland has accepted the interim position at Trinity in Detroit Lakes. And of course, Emily Papke Larson started up at First in Bemidji, and Tammy Jacobson, it's Sverdrup, and Tingvold, and Amy Kelly is a seminary student who's going to be helping out at August Dana in Fergus Falls, and Doug Stavi has been just absolutely rock solid in helping us with all kinds of interim positions and is still at Bethlehem in Fergus Falls. And we are going to be welcoming Lauren Mellum back to our synod starting in mid-August shortly. And Pastor Ali Tulu has just accepted the call at Breckenridge. And so there will be a transition there. Pastor Sarah Dill has been helping us out at Faith in Pelican Rapids as they as an interim. And we appreciate the work that's being done there. Clay Ellingson accepted the job at Grove Lake. And Dale Peplinjack is helping us out at Fox Home in Vuku. And Bradley Pearson is a new pastor who will be coming in to Grace Through Faith in Brandon and Evansville. He's coming from the Eastern North Dakota Synod. And I know that I have missed people in all of this, but I just want you to know that the Synod staff, our engagement ministers, call committees, and councils have been hard at work during this past year and a half just to work through all of these transitions. And I really, when you maybe in hindsight see it more than you do in the moment, but God's Spirit has been at work in spite of the challenges. And I am just so happy to welcome new people into our synod and to share in the excitement as people move into or transition into different congregations. So I hope maybe we could just do a round of applause for all the work that's going on throughout our synod and just celebrate the work of God's Holy Spirit. Chris, did I miss anything?
I think that's the main stuff. Also at the conference dean's call, we talked about COVID and just how difficult it is in the congregation. Back in March of 2020, we were thinking it was going to be like an 8-week deal. And now we're into month, feels like a million. And so it feels a little the same, but it feels a little different as well. And so we wanted to take, we'll probably take 10 minutes. I broke us into three groups. Pastor Keith and Pastor Carla and myself will help facilitate in those groups. And we want to hear from you what your congregations and what you need coming up into this next fall time. And so share with us what you need from us so we know what to pull together. There is Bishop Bill, we put out a new vaccine video. Bishop Bill speaks to our Lutheran understanding of why vaccines are important. And he also interviews Pastor Kathy Rose, who has a unique experience with vaccines as she contracted polio as a young girl. And so that is out there in the wavelength. There'll be a link to that in tomorrow's Northern Lights. But we want to hear from you. Boots on the ground people, what would be helpful? So I'm going to open up those rooms and share, and then we'll come back together. But it will be helpful to know what you guys need. So there we go. I'm going to resume the recording again. So a couple of other things to be mindful of the time, is next summer, there's going to be an ELCA youth gathering in Minneapolis, in sort of our backyard. I'm offering two information meetings next Tuesday, a noon meeting and a 7 p.m. meeting. The intended audience would be like your trip leader, or if you have like a couple of parents that are interested. But I'm going to be talking about picking good adult leaders. And so it's probably not for every adult that wants to go to the ELCA youth gathering. because the wrong adult leader can really ruin a trip. I've seen, I've experienced from other things. And so that login information will be in tomorrow's Northern Lights, but the agendas are the same. So it's whatever one works best for your people or you. And I'm going to record the evening meeting. So like if Tuesday is a bad day for all of your people, I'll get the recording up. So there's that. And the next thing on the agenda is some synod use stuff. The LYO board met a couple weeks ago, and we really want to have a middle school gathering. But much like all things, we're trying to figure out how to do it safely and what to do. And so we're tossing around a few ideas, cautiously optimistic that we can have a regular middle school youth gathering. It would be at Luther Fest the weekend before Thanksgiving. And more information will be coming out about that. For senior high, we're going to be doing something different that I am very excited about. We are going to be doing what I'm calling right now is a leadership lab. And so every congregation or parish can invite two or three youth age ninth grade through 12th grade that are just great leaders. It could be your high schooler if you have one on your church council. It could be that high schooler that like reads on Sunday mornings, or someone that's active. It can be anything, anyone that you see that has leadership skills. And we're going to do more of a leadership training. So it'll be a caring adult from your congregation. It could be you, could be a different staff person. It could be just a great parent that cares. And then those couple of you, we've set aside some money from Giving Hearts Day to help supplement this. And so right now it's looking like it will be a meeting a couple of times via Zoom, because high schoolers are just so darn busy. So a few times meeting via Zoom. Probably you can safely gather as your church. So like your church's group could be together for those meetings. And then I'm hopeful that we can meet one day in person. And we will be digging into servant leadership and peer ministry and how to be a good leader and what that looks different than what society says as a leader, right? And so that will roll out this winter, probably after Christmas, because this fall is really busy and everything is still up in the air. And so those are coming down the pipe. I'm excited about how things are shaping up, but we just can't land on things right now on timing and what exactly we're going to do. But once those things get solidified, we'll be getting information out to you, rostered leaders and SAMs, and whoever does your youth, if you have a youth board or whatever, would be the ones that pick the youth to be part of it. And you can choose in your congregation to do it how you wish. So any questions about those things? I'm kind of excited to do youth stuff again and wear that part of my hat. I've been communicating mostly. So I'm excited to get back and get after some youth stuff. You know how to get a hold of me. I'm the one who sends you all the emails, so you can just hit reply to one of them. An email I got from Bishop Bill that I haven't had a chance to look at because he sent it to me right at the beginning of this meeting is he forwarded some information from Tom Cunoff, who is the ELCA General Counsel, on public service loan forgiveness expanded today for clergy and religious workers. So for those of you who have student loans, this could be exciting. Is a link. I'm doing some more digging into it because I don't know anything about it yet. But the note from Tom Cunha is that If religious workers are applying for the forgiveness, they need to get the form completed by their employer. Synod should not be completing forms for congregational staff. Churchwide won't be completing forms for synod and congregational staff. So it would be like my understanding. I'll put that in there because again, I just got this email, and I'll put some links in tomorrow's Northern Links. But that's the information I just got from Bishop Bill. He told me to push it out. And so I wanted to push it out to you all. Check it out if you have student loans. It's not, there's like different things because it's federal student loan stuff. So I can't answer any questions. I just gave you all the information about that, that you now know as much as I know about that, but I'll do some digging before tomorrow's Northern Lights goes out. All right, I'm gonna stop talking because I've talked too much. If you have questions or whatever, and I'm gonna pass the baton back to Pastor Carla.
I just wanna end our time by, again, a big thank you to all of you for the leadership that you bring to this synod and to your congregations and community. Christ, the Holy Spirit is working through Christ and in your lives and in the lives of your congregations. And I just give thanks for all the work that you do and really just so appreciative. Our whole staff is very appreciative of your continued work and your continued ministry. And we just, if there's things that you need from us, please don't hesitate to reach out. And we will try to respond in the best way that we possibly can. So I thank you all for your time today, and God's blessings to you as you go forth for the rest of this week. And may you be filled and sustained by the love of Christ. Have a great day.
Also with you.
Yep. Bye-bye.